Good evening. Will the planning board please come to order? And just for the record, we are all present, and with the exception of Mr. Tinsman, who I think will be joining us shortly. For those of you who are curious or devotees of the planning board activities, I would just like to let you know that the television station which you will see us upon has been changed from Channel 7 to Channel 38. This will be starting in October, so you might want to bear that in mind. Don't let our ratings drop. And it will be Channel 38 that you will want to watch. We have the minutes of the August 16th meeting. Are there any additions or corrections to those?
I have one. This is the last page. It might be confusing once we get it corrected, but we are setting the hearing for September 19th. There is change to September 19th.
Right. There are two dates there that need to be corrected. Any other corrections or amendments to the minutes? If not, all those in favor, please raise your right hand. And opposed, they are accepted and approved. We have a few items of correspondence. A letter from Mr. Hunter to Mr. McVane, dated August 17th, on the site distance of the Hennessy property. A letter to the chairperson of the planning board from Mr. Hansen, dated the 17th of August. A letter to Mr. Daigle, the assessing and codes office, dated August 18th, regarding the Allen Balfour zone change request. And a letter from Mr. Hunter, dated August 17th, regarding Ibis Corporation's construction cost estimate. A letter dated September 16th to the chairperson of the planning board on Spinnaker Heights subdivision by Mr. Leahy. Is there any other correspondence? A letter dated September 1st to the chairperson of the planning board from Mr. Leahy, also about the Allen Balfour zone change request. Any other correspondence?
I don't know whether we should bring it up as correspondence, but I was contacted by Mr. Jordan Butter of the Hennessy property. I think maybe talk to you also about the paving of the area that was accessing that property in the back.
Which property are we talking of? Balfour's?
No, the back of the area addition Hennessy.
Oh. I believe the perhaps the code enforcement officer can enlighten us about the resolution of that. I was contacted by Mr. Murray.
Murray, I'm sorry, Murray. Excuse
not Mr. Jordan, but Mr. Murray, in regards to the property.
There was a question to bring the board up to what we're talking about. Was the physical barrier that the board had determined it would like to have between the parking lot and the private road.
That's the point, yeah.
In the actual determination of what was to be done after the meeting had been concluded, were there the minutes. And reading the minutes, the decision did not incorporate any of these physical barriers or the discussion of these physical barriers. We did review the videotape, thanks to the TV.
Instant replay.
And we saw, or went to the point where the discussion took place. Dick had mentioned that items such as trees would make good buffers, grass, these kinds of things would be a good physical barrier. And we took it to mean that two physical posts and a chain would be enough. In going back, though, we did come back with the a different interpretation that a grafting strip would be more appropriate. We discussed it with Mr. Hennessy, and you now will have two posts, a chain, and some grass at the barrier.
Okay, great. I just wanted to know what the result. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Daigle. our first item of business tonight is a public hearing, a proposed zoning ordinance revision on farm and fish markets. This is a public hearing, so I would ask that any member of the public who wishes to speak, would you please come to the microphone and state your name and give your address. Before opening the public hearing, I'd just like to thank Mr. Tinsman, who chaired the committee that brought this ordinance forward, along with Marion Guthrie, who served on it, some zoning board members, and also we're very grateful to members of the fishing and farming community who participated in this process. When the planning board met 7 or 8 months ago, it became obvious that the philosophy of this particular area needed a lot of needed to be thoroughly aired and some concepts discussed before drafting an ordinance that would serve the town well. And I think that we've arrived. And maybe Dick, you'd like to just say a little bit before we open the public hearing.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. I haven't prepared anything other than maybe at the conclusion of the public hearing that we can talk about it and talk about any questions. I know that there are also committee members here tonight that do wish to speak about it. And you've given a good synopsis of where we've come from the planning board's perspective. And yet the philosophy that I think the committee wishes to take into the deliberations on the part of the town fathers, Council Planning Board, is that there's been a lot of historical precedents in the town that have been lost over the past couple of decades, and where this used to be a farming and fishing community, that at least the committee would like to recommend that we try to retain some of our past and encourage the farming and fishing community to prosper in the town. And a lot of the specifics in the regulations are designed to do just that, by providing an economic source for product that is grown or brought ashore by residents. So with that, I'm going to
thank you, Mr. Tinsman. With that, I will now open the public hearing and ask if there are any members who would like to come forward and speak about this.
My name is Jacqueline Kurz. I'm an attorney representing Carolyn Pollock in an appeal from the Zoning Board of Appeals approval of Kenneth Maxwell's permit for a farm market on Spurwink Avenue. I have a couple of comments tonight that I'd like to make with respect to the proposed amendment before you. And although on the face of it, it looks like it's written for Mr. Maxwell, I would like to think that there are probably other fishermen and farmers in the town that will benefit from this. However, by allowing a commercial use of such as a farm market in the residential district, you are, in essence, going to be changing the character of that residential district. What you have before you is a proposal to change a zone without actually going through a zone change. You are not going to be giving notice to abutters of what adjacent properties may be undergoing in change. Your zoning ordinance requires that a zone change be compatible with the surrounding neighborhood, and secondly, that there would be no adverse effect on the value of the adjacent properties. And clearly, in this case, a farm market such as Mr. Maxwell is proposing on Spurwink Avenue very definitely is not compatible with the surrounding neighborhood, which consists primarily of residences. And secondly, it's going to have an adverse effect on the value of those adjacent residential properties. Your zoning ordinance also requires that any zone change be compatible with your comprehensive plan. And in reviewing the comprehensive plan for the town of Cape Elizabeth, I found that in 1980, when that drafting committee met to recommend the comprehensive plan, that they actually reduced the number of business districts in the town. They reduced at least by two business districts and said that henceforth all business development should occur in a business district. And they said that it should start with the existing business district and spread out from there if that would be the future of the town. I don't think they contemplated you would be spot zoning by allowing farm markets or commercial uses of property to be allowed in a residential zone. It's conceivable under this amendment that you have before you tonight that there would be a wholesale marketing of produce or fish. It's also conceivable that you're going to be having storage of this farm produce, storage of fish, which I don't think is being taken into consideration. There are going to have to be cleaning facilities for produce, cleaning facilities for fish that are brought in for sale. And you could likely end up with a distribution center for any farm produce grown on that land or any fish brought in for resale. There is furthermore no limitation on the size or the scope of any proposed market that would be put into effect. And there is actually, I think if you read the proposal, an incentive probably to go toward the larger size of a building because the related market products that can be sold are directly tied into the square footage of the proposed building, so that you can sell no more than 25% of related market products of the overall structure. So the larger the structure is, the more related market products can be sold. So I would just bring these points to your attention and caution the board that although I think the intended effect is to give Mr. Maxwell probably his approvals under this amendment, that it's going to have far more reaching effect than what the short-sighted, I think, intention is. And I would urge you not to support this amendment in its present form to the town council.
Thank you very much. If I may, I would just like to comment that the ordinance drafting committee, I'm quite certain, really did not intend to draft an ordinance that would be tailored to one specific person in the town. That would really be going against all of our principles. And there are a lot of other fishermen and farmers in the town, so I just want to correct
that
impression.
I'm sure it's just the timing of it.
Thank you. Any other members of the public that might like to speak? I would just explain that if the Mr. Jordan,
Bill Jordan, Wells Road, Cape Elizabeth. I'm just here. I was on the committee there as far as this farm and fish market and deal is concerned, and what we had in the ordinance before was just for roadside stands, and it was geared more or less just for what you raise of your own land, and you weren't only purchase other materials in to be able to sell. And the idea of this change is to make it viable So if a guy wants a roadside stand, farm market, fish market, that he can handle some other type produce when it's out of season in the greater Portland area or in Maine, can bring it in and also be able to make a living at the deal. Now, I think what this ordinance has done, maybe it is, as she said, geared for Mr. Maxwell, but this isn't geared for any one person, Mr. Maxwell or anybody else. It's geared for any farmer or fisherman in Cape Elizabeth that wants to start a farm or fish market and make a living at it. Now, I don't know whether there's enough foolish guys around here to try it or not, but there is a few around here that don't know any better that might like to attempt and do that. And it's the greatest way to get some open space left in Cape Elizabeth to have the farmers around, I would think. Now, maybe the lady would rather have Kenny Marshall put in, fill that place full of houses, which I think would be pathetic. And if he's able to operate the farm and this change will be a help to him, I think it should be supported.
Thank you, Mr. Jordan. Anyone else might like to speak? Mr. Maxwell.
I'm the infamous Mr. Maxwell. I don't know if you remember, but on back in February, I came before this meeting, this board, to initiate the beginning of what I hope to be would be a retail market in the town. Time has flown, another season's come and gone, and I don't know if I even want to be farming anymore after this last year, but farmers are hard to the type of person to get them to quit, so we'll probably try it again another year. I was on this committee, but believe you me, I can tell you this wasn't geared to me. The zoning board, or this board, I believe, has already thrown this in my face and saying, now, Mr. Maxwell, you know what the committee is recommending now, you know, which is far more than what I'm required to at this time. I've already heard that said. we've broken this up in two situations now. One is a fish farm market, a business venture, and this has got to be on a regular-sized house lot, or where I am, it's got to be a double house lot. Now, you price house lots in the town of Cape Elizabeth, and that's a little bit of investment right there. I am working hard now, doing site plan, preparing to come before you. With all the rest of that, that will be necessary before I can sell a cucumber or a tomato from my plot of land over there. So to think that this makes it real easy for an individual to jump in it the way I am trying to do it, it's absolutely untrue. Now, we have also left the smaller businesses, the home occupation type businesses, left them more or less as they are. They're controlled pretty well. And I can see some farmers getting into this type of a thing with a small amount of acreage, selling small amounts of vegetables, whether it be a card table or whatever it is, but this will be controlled as it is apparently presently. I don't think we changed that at all as far as on the home occupation type of a thing. So one thing that we have got to realize as we approach the 1980 and 1990s as we're coming into, that agriculture is changing. We have got to update it to modern agriculture, and there are an awful lot of our citizens that love the beautiful dairy farm and those type of things, but they don't realize that somewhere out back, if you're going to make milk, there's going to be a pile of manure. Okay, now I'm not going to have a pile of manure in the front of my yard over there, but the dairy farmer has got to have an outlet to spread his manure or do this and that, or he's not going to have his dairy farm. You've got to argue that, you've got to just realize that. You've got to provide the farmer with a chance to sell his product. One of the men on the zoning board say, hey, I've got to realize that farming today is a business. And it is. Now, you cannot have both. You cannot have those beautiful countryside sceneries that we love in the Cape and expect the farmer to maintain them for you unless you give him a way of selling and making money, making a business success in doing so. I do not see any movement in the town to purchase this land, to maintain its beauty, this type of thing. And so we're set up here that to have a farm market, he's got to maintain so many acres of open space, agricultural land in the town. Anybody that does this will be maintaining that for the town absolutely free. Now, if he makes a dollar on the side, I hope that's permissible. And I would encourage its passage. I know that this is only the beginning of it, but if I can answer any questions, anything at all, we'd be glad to do it.
Any questions from members of the board? Thank you, Mr. Maxwell. I might just explain that if this ordinance is adopted, it will be sent on to the town council, where it would yet undergo another public hearing, just to make you all aware of what the process is.
My name is Stu Rich. I live on the Ram Island Farm down in Cape Elizabeth. I manage Seaward Nurseries. I must say I take a very little bit of offense to all the credit that Ken Maxwell is getting for being the only one to be selling agricultural products out of Cape this evening. I think it was this very ordinance that gave us such a hard time about a year ago. We almost got shut down for trying to grow agricultural products in the Cape town of Cape Elizabeth. And this process, because of our problems and Ken's problems, has been initiated, and we've tried to come to grips with all the policy questions involved and make some progress. I think we all feel very strongly about what the preservation of open space means to us in terms of the quality of life that it affords us, the kind of heritage that it represents, and if we must be perfectly banal about it, the way that it protects our property values. I'm sure that the property values on Spurwink Road would plummet if Ken Maxwell was to plow that all into the allowable number of house lots and increase traffic, etc. We need very much in the town of Cape Elizabeth to do whatever we can to preserve the kind of open space that we have now. The town can't afford to buy out Ken Maxwell and what he's doing, and even if they could, they couldn't afford to hire him to keep it open like he is. Agriculture is a for-profit organization, has been since the 1600s, since they settled Richmond Island. In the economic climate that we're experiencing now, it's becoming much more difficult for anybody producing agricultural crops, especially in the kind of development pressure that we're experiencing in Cape Elizabeth. To make ends meet, we need, as a town, to support what Kenny Maxwell and Billy Jordan are doing in order to preserve that kind of land use. We've all spent a good deal of time brainstorming on this amendment or this ordinance change, trying to preserve the quality of life and property values for everybody in the town. We hope that we have come up with a workable compromise, and we hope that you will lend it your support. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Rich. Are there any other members of the public?
I'm Marge Dunham. I live at Spurwink Avenue. And it's easy for our wee lazy ones to follow Stuart Rich because we don't have to say much. He's covered all the pertinent points. But I'd just like to add my few little words. I'd like to help preserve the open farmland. What are the 3 farmers left in Cape Elizabeth? We're being out-yuppied left and right. And to see the farmers and fishermen get a break would be, I think, highly desirable. And I'd just like to say that I'm all for whatever they want to do. And I think many others would be too, and I wish they had come to speak. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Dunham.
Could you give us your address on Spurwink Avenue, please? I'm sorry. I didn't get the number.
495.
495.
How does that relate to the farm market that Mr. Maxwell is proposing? Are you close, or?
No, we're not. I wish we were.
Are there some other members of the public that would like to speak on this?
My name is Rick Marshall. I'm from Ramon Farm. And I completely agree with everything that's been said so far, except for the first one. And I just feel like I want to point out that we looked at the legal ramifications very closely, I think, of what we did on this committee. I was a part of this committee. This is not a zoning change at all. What this is a clarification of an existing situation that is not at all tenable. Agriculture has always been permitted in these zones, and any agricultural use, including barns, which can be, in modern times, a distribution center, is permitted under the existing ordinance. What this really does is restrict and clarify. It doesn't permit anything new, and it doesn't expand the rights of the farmers at all. It simply clarifies the old tradition that's always been here. There are states where, by state law, the farmer has the right to open a retail market on their land. I hope that the board will pass it on to the council. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Marshall. Are there any other interested members of the public that would like to speak? If not, I will close the public hearing and would like the members of the planning board to discuss the outcome of this particular proposal and what they feel should be done with it. I think, again, that I would like to say I think an excellent job has been done. This has been very carefully looked at. It adheres to our comprehensive plan in that we do want to foster the economic life of fishermen and farmers in the town, and we do want to maintain rural open space, and we only have a small vestige of that left in this town, so that I do personally heartily endorse this.
Just a brief comment, Alice. Like most of the planning board members, I have followed the development of this ordinance. Fortunately, I was not on that particular committee. I'm not sure I had the time to devote to it last year. I know the amount of time that was devoted to it. I respect the concerns of people who might live near the first person to invoke an ordinance, or those who perhaps have been instrumental in its passage, because they might be the first ones to take advantage of it. But on the other hand, I think the ordinance has to be viewed as a compromise, because it certainly is that. Unlike a lot of other ordinances, it wasn't pushed through quickly, and it also was intended to strike a balance. And I think it does just that. It preserves what most Cape residents value highly in the Cape, but I think it also puts a fairly heavy burden on those who would take advantage of it, so that we just aren't going to see a bunch of businesses springing up alongside our streets. With that having been said, I just can't think of a more perfect balance in our ordinances, and I would move that we pass this ordinance on to the council with our approval.
Any other? It has been moved and seconded. Is there any discussion? I hope to. Yes, go ahead.
Just one question. The nice young lady who is an attorney mentioned that the business districts would be the comprehensive plan stimulated reduced business districts. And of course, Mrs. Rand has just made reference to the comprehensive plan, hoping to promote the rural character and agricultural land. And I mean, I have quite a few specific instances here when preserving the rural character of Cape Elizabeth comes up. And I thought it was very interesting that Mr. Maxwell, along with Mr. Rich and a few others, mentioned that farming is a business. Well, I think it's not only a business, but I view it as a profession. And is there not a professional building on Spurwink Avenue adjacent to this farm where I think a number of professional doctors and dentists operate what is essentially a business?
I believe the answer is yes to that, Mrs. Gossie.
Does your client live in proximity to that building?
Yes, she does live in proximity to the medical center that we're speaking of. However, that was a permitted use in the residential district that she purchased her house. A retail store permitting operation of the nature that Mr. Maxwell proposes was not an allowed use, nor accessory use or any other use allowed in the residential district. And I think that's what she was protesting.
I see. Thank you.
Are there any other points of discussion? Mr. Tinsman, did your committee discuss the idea of setting hours of operation in the ordinance? And how did you conclude to leave it out?
Madam Chairman, there are very strong performance standards that are attached to the condition on market provision. Including a very lengthy discussion about the hours of operation that transited a couple of meetings. The decision to not do hours of operation related as much to the type of business that it is, where typically farming operations are seasonal, very heavily oriented toward the summer and the fall. It just didn't appear to be a real good criteria for whether it be 8 o'clock or 9 o'clock or 10 o'clock or 11 o'clock or whatever it might be. We talked about everything from for efficient farm markets from Christmas trees to cucumbers. And as you're aware, there were probably 8 or 9 meetings in this committee in several months. Hours of operation were discussed. They have not been proposed in the final draft. That had been discussed. One of the reasons, as well as the hours of operation for Christmas trees or for cucumbers at 9 o'clock before sunrise in the summertime, was that with a strong performance criteria and recognizing that fish and farm market could go into a residential neighborhood along an arterial or feeder road, which are two of the primary criteria. As well as being in the residential district, was that with a very strong performance criteria, how that fish and farm market could be sited on a piece of property of a certain size, that there would be the removal of the potential for mitigating the potential for impact on residential properties as much as you could in a farming operation. I don't know that we brought all of the charts tonight for showing how efficient farm markets could be lighted on people, and that would certainly be provided to the council to prepare some things in the background for the council. But there was a real strong attempt at mitigating potential for impact, adverse impact on residential property and residential neighborhood by having a very strong siting criteria, setbacks, buffer areas, side yard restrictions, where signs would be placed, where parking would be placed, and things of that nature.
So you felt that the standards would not, as they were set up, would not infringe on the abutters or property rights of abutters by making those standards as tight as you do.
Yes, ma'am. That is the feeling of the committee. Mm-hmm. And yet, those same criteria that you're talking about are very subjective. What is intrusion on one person's perspective may not be intrusion on another person's perspective. And it really depends on how you are affected and whether you see something arise out of a field with a parking lot in front of it where pumpkins are being sold, or whether it's a successful continuing abuse of something field. So I think that a lot of those criteria are very subjective. What the committee had to do was jump over potential for subjective thinking and think about wherever in the community the fish and farm stand could locate, whether or not objectively the criteria were satisfied as strongly as any other use in the town, that the greatest potential possible that any adverse effects were mitigated. And that's what the board said.
Oh, thank you, Mr. Timsman. Are there any other questions or points of discussion? If not, you have a motion in front of you, and it has been moved and seconded. All those in favor, please raise your right hand. And opposed? It is unanimous. And thank you again for all your hard work, and particularly the farmers and fishermen who also participated in this. Our next item of business was to be a request for a wetlands alteration permit, but they have requested, the developers have requested that we adjourn the public hearing for an unspecified time period, and I wondered if we could have a motion from a board member to that purpose.
In order that the request by Gold Crest Development Corporation for an adjournment of the wetlands alteration public hearing regarding Gold Crest Farm for an unspecified period of time be granted according to section 19-3-9 of the zoning ordinance and the facts presented.
Is there a second? Has been moved and seconded. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Ms. Carey. And one more motion, if I can ask your indulgence. As a request for the applicant to be tabled until the October meeting. Would someone like to move that? Would you like to repeat your performance, Mr. Moss?
Sure, why not? Be it ordered that a request by Gold Crest Development Corporation for another 1 month tabling of consideration of Gold Crest Farm, a proposed 38-lot subdivision located off Spurwick Avenue, be granted according to section 16-2-4 of the subdivision ordinance and the facts presented.
Madam Chairman, I would second that with a comment. The town of Cape Elizabeth is noted for its long review process in reviewing subdivision proposals that come before. And in summary fashion, we're noted for spending 18 months reviewing some subdivisions and maybe driving up the cost of homes. And yet, this is an example for developers requesting tabling motions, and I just hope that at the end of this, somebody doesn't bring up the fact that this applicant submitted a proposal in April of 1988, here it is in July of 1989, without a very hard-hitting progression of submissions by the applicant. So I would second it.
Well said, and thank you for protecting our actions and our role as planning board members. It isn't always our fault that applications take a long time to move through. All those in favor of the motion?
Can we have some discussion on this?
Yes.
I just have one, maybe not a point of discussion, but a question, even though I made the motion. Are we running into any kind of deadline problems? Does this create any kind of problems with our ordinance or our procedures?
Under our ordinance, we can do this to a mutually agreeable time with the applicant at this point.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
Any other discussion? All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? It is carried.
Our next item of business is another public hearing. And Mr. I. Allen Balfour has a request for a zone change from a resource protection district to a resident A district. Again, I'd just like to go over the ground rules for a public hearing. If any members of the public would like to speak, if you would be good enough to come forward and give both your name and address. Clearly, that would be very helpful for our tape. Also, before opening the public hearing, I would just like to caution board members and members of the public that the purpose of our business here tonight is solely to consider a zone change from a zone, a resource protection zone, to a resident A zone. And we are not here to debate or to discuss subdivisions, roads, ownership of roads, or sewer hookups, or any of those other matters. So with that preface, I would like to ask perhaps Mr. Dale to make a brief presentation, and I will open the public hearing now.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. My name is Bill Dale. I'm a lawyer from Portland. I'm here tonight on behalf of Allen Balfour, the proponent of this zone change request. We are here seeking Planning Board's recommendation to the Town Council on the change of zone of approximately 5 acres of land adjacent to the existing Broad Cove residential subdivision from resource protection to residence A. All is more fully detailed in our previous letter to the town manager dated February 11th and in the various technical submissions which our engineer made in June of this year. With me tonight are Walt Stinson, our engineer from Sebago Technics, and Mr. Balfour, who is the applicant. With the board's permission, I would like to make a brief presentation. I confess not having too much new, having been before you 3 or 4 times on this already, but I thought it might help focus both the board's attention and perhaps the neighbors' comments if I went through a brief presentation, if I may.
Fine.
I stand off here. Can everybody see and hear all right? I've put on the easel copy of the plan which we have submitted, which shows the land which we want rezoned from resource protection to residence A. Let me orient everybody to the plan. This is Broad Cove Road coming in. This is the ocean down on the right-hand side of the plan. Over here on the left-hand or southwesterly side of the plan is what's known as Pine Ridge Road Extension, coming around this way to the existing terminus of Pine Ridge Road. Mr. Balfour owns the 13 remaining lots from his original subdivision plan from 1964, approximately 130 lots approved by the Planning Board for single-family home purposes. These are the last 13 lots. He has built out, as I'm sure everybody knows, the rest of the subdivision, and is now here seeking a zone change so that he in turn could build out with single-family homes these remaining 13 lots. Mr. Balfour has spent, in the course of building the infrastructure for the rest of the subdivision, some $500,000 in terms of infrastructure to support the rest of the subdivision. In approximately 1979, the town of Cape Elizabeth rezoned a portion of this land, and as is applicable here, perhaps if I draw it in red, it will show more clearly. rezoned in 1979. This portion of land, which I have now highlighted in red, and it continues out this way towards the Route 77 and Two Lights Road off on the left-hand side, to resource protection. And that is the problem that we seek redress on tonight, because under the zoning ordinance, resource protection zoning does not allow the construction of single-family homes. As you can see, our zone change request is shown on the map which we previously submitted to you. Is with regards to those portions of the 13 lots that Mr. Balfour owns that are zoned resource protection. It is not all of them, however, it is most of them. Let me show you here on crosshatch. The ones that we're referring to. Our original zone change request, as submitted in February, has been amended just last month based on a comment raised by one of the neighbors about Mr. Balfour having sold off a portion of this land, and that I have confirmed that with him, and indeed, this portion of the interior roadway is on the southwesterly side of the lot. He has sold off the fee simple title to that. The joint venture that he was in with Maine Savings Bank was his nominee on this property. He no longer owns that. He continues to own the title to this portion of the road here, but not that. So we have amended our zone change request based on the comments of the request of the planning board to exclude that portion of the roadway right there. We believe that, although I'm not sure it's particularly pertinent tonight, Mr. Balfour nonetheless retains the right of passage across that under Maine law. We have submitted, as the ordinance requires and as the planning board has requested on a couple of occasions, plans from our engineers, Sebago Technic, showing the various things that your ordinance requires, such as soil conditions and so forth, and I believe you have all of those materials. I think, Madam Chairman, that adequately lays out, at least from our perspective, the background on the facts of this. If I may, I would like to present to you just our two arguments why we think it's appropriate for the Planning Board to recommend that the Town Council amend this zone from resource protection to Residence A. The first, a very practical reason, I'm sure there's nobody in the room that's going to be surprised by this, and that is that Mr. Balfour has previously built out approximately another 120 lots in this subdivision. These are the last 13. He would like to develop those for single-family homes and sell those off. I won't spend a lot of time on that. I think that's probably pretty obvious. So that's his intention, is to put nice single-family homes, very similar, I suspect, to all the rest of the single-family homes that are already in the neighborhood. The second reason is perhaps a little more legal, technical reason, in compliance with the requirements of your zoning ordinance, that we identify certain things which indicate that our zone change request is consistent to and pursuant to and consistent with your comprehensive plan as required by state law. Your ordinance alludes to that, and the planning board asked me at a recent meeting if I would put all of those things in writing, and I have done so. In part, Sebago Technic did it in a technical letter, which they sent to you, indicating the buildability, from a technical standpoint, of these various lots and the ability to put houses on them. Probably none of that comes as much of a surprise, given today's technology, as you can see from the plan. Even this portion, which is not part of our property over here, but is zoned resource protection, does have houses on it. This one being constructed, I think, in 1978, this one in 1967, this one in 1976, this one in 1972 on this one, and 1963 on this one. In addition, I've also put in a letter from me to the board our thoughts on how we think this zone change request is consistent with a comprehensive plan in terms of promoting residential housing in the community. That's one of the overall goals of your comprehensive plan. Obviously, it's exactly what Mr. Balfour intends to do with this zone change, should it be granted to him. But we think it's pretty clear that this is a Broad Cove subdivision. It's a nice subdivision, which has been a very good addition to the community and a real asset to the community in terms of providing housing. We think that follows as well for this property. The third general goal of your comprehensive plan, which we think is the second point supporting this, is the provision of quality community services. I think we have made the point previously, and I will repeat tonight. One of the advantages to the zone change here and the possible development of this land for single-family house lots is the construction of this interior roadway to serve as a second means of access to all of the rest of the single-family homes within the Broad Cove subdivision. That's something that obviously the developer would end up doing at his own expense and not the town's. And then the fourth standard in your comprehensive plan, which we think serves as a third basis in support of this zone change request, is to avoid any sort of unfair disadvantage to property owners as a result of zoning. That may be, in some, the heart of our argument. This is a large tract that Mr. Balfour has developed over the years for single-family homes. I think pretty clearly done a nice job on. For him at the end here to be denied the opportunity to develop the last 13 lots strikes him as unfair, and that's why we're here tonight seeking initially the Planning Board's comments and ultimately the Town Council's decision on this zone change request. With that, Madam Chairman, I will stop my remarks, but both Walter and I, as well as Mr. Balfour, would be pleased to respond to any questions that the Board has or members of the public.
Thank you. I think we'll perhaps turn to members of the public now and see if there are some people who might like to make some comments or ask questions.
My name is Edward Perry. I live at 10 Pine Tree Shores.
Mr. Perry.
My name is Edward Perry. I live on 10 Pine Ridge Road, which abuts the property which plans to be, which Mr. Balfour plans to develop. It's interesting that everything that Mr. Dale has just said, in looking through the letter I believe he's referring to, I'm afraid I disagree with a lot of the points. I believe the letter he's referring to, where most of these points about the comprehensive plan, is a July 29th, 1988 letter, where he describes how he meets the three of the four towns' comprehensive plan land use goals. The first one is not addressed in his letter, and that is the one of preservation of rural character. The second one, which is interpreted one way in the letter, and my interpretation of goal two, is the achievement of balanced development in Cape Elizabeth, and specifically in reference to building house types which are non-disruptive to the residential and rural character of the town. Well, the present Broad Cove, my understanding of what Broad Cove is not 130 house lots. Anybody can take out the Broad Cove subdivision plan, count the house lots, and come up with over 200 house lots, most of which are half-acre house lots. Out of this 200 house lots, there's one tiny open space, and that is, our calculations show it as 7.5 acres instead of the 5. And that tiny open space is this, right here. Everything else, every other piece of land down there is developed or will be developed in the next few years. I don't see how the Broad Cove development is going to reach that retention of rural character of the town in Goal 2 as it is, and take away these 13 house lots and this 7.8 acres, and I think it gets even farther away from retention of the rural character of the town. The third goal that the applicant addresses is the provision of quality community services, and in specific, the road access, which is a major point of discussion in Broad Cove. He feels he does this by providing a second access. It doesn't say in the letter the, it says a second access to Broad Cove with the proposed roadway. And I'm glad he clarified by saying it's really an interior access. It's not an access to the outside, because you still have to drive on the original Broad Cove Road for about 0.4 miles before you get to this interior access. In talking to Mike McGovern, we learned that it's considered that the midpoint of traffic in Broad Cove is the intersection of Hunts Point Road and Salt Spray Lane. Well, any person can take the map of Broad Cove and look where that is and see that if we consider the Pine Ridge Road extension a second access, what you're doing is putting a second access one block apart from the first one and both way on one side of the midpoint of the traffic flow of the development, which doesn't seem to make much sense. The second or the third point on the road is one that I'm sure people would have loved to speak on tonight, and that is as a shortcut. During the sewer construction, when this whole thing really started, Pine Ridge Road was opened up as a temporary road to allow cars to pass through during sewer construction. And people thought this was a great savings. If you take a tape measure and walk down, the difference between driving down Broad Cove Road to Salt Spray Lane and driving down Pine Ridge Road and its extension to Salt Spray Lane, there's a difference of 400 feet. Well, at 25 miles an hour, that's a savings of about 12 seconds. It's a little less of a savings for certain drivers in Broad Cove, but at 25 miles an hour, it's a 12-second savings. It's not really a shortcut. In addition to not being a proper access, in August 1987, the planning board already denied a building permit for this road. And the only reason the roadbed exists is, and I quote from the minutes of that meeting, Mr. Dale's feeling, also supported by Dr. Rand, was that to remove this fill would only serve to further disturb the wetlands. And that's why the roadbed exists today. The last land use goal of the town's comprehensive plan, which the applicant addresses in his letter, is that the town will achieve its conservation, development, and service goals in a manner which avoids unfair advantage or disadvantage to any of its landowners or taxpayers. And of course, the applicant feels he's being put at a disadvantage. As he just mentioned, he's being denied building on his 13 house lots. He doesn't mention that he's already profited from the development of over 200 house lots, and that his assessment on these lots has been an unbuildable assessment. So his tax rate has been much lower than anybody else's in the neighborhood. I think the assessment is around $15,000 or $16,000 a lot, which is slightly below what the rest of the lots in Broad Cove are assessed at. The next major point of the applicant's letter is that the resource protection zone goes beyond the areas containing Sebago Mucky Peat, and I'm sure that will be addressed in a few minutes. And to quote the letter, in fact, lots 100, 101, 102, 90, and 97 have no Sebago Mucky Peat in whole or in part. However, you can read the letter another way. This is the way I read it. To quote from Darryl Brown's soil report, and this is another soil report paid for by the developer, Sebago Mucky Peat dominates the site, with the exception of lots 100, 101, and 102, and portions of 90 and 97. There are two wet areas on lots 97 and 100 that are ponded areas. Well, I guess that's a way of saying they have ponds on them. They're not Sebago Mucky Peat. They have ponds on them instead. Also, it must be remembered that Sebago Mucky Peat is not the only quality which determines wetlands. The applicant concludes his argument in the letter for the zone change with two final points. The 13 house lots would be an asset to the community. That's a quote. I think, and I think other people will agree with me in the neighborhood, that some open space would be more of an asset to the neighborhood. And to quote, that existing Broad Cove lot owners bought their lots as part of an overall plan as approved in 1964 with these 13 lots included. Well, this is true. It's true if you bought your lot before the rezoning, but many people have moved into Broad Cove since the rezoning. Some people recently moving into the Pine Ridge Road area were concerned enough about this to go down to Town Hall and find out exactly what was going to happen with this resource protection zone, where they were assured this is a wetlands. And it was left at that. In conclusion, the people in our neighborhood, or I feel the people in our neighborhood, do not need another 13 house lots to add to the 220 already constructed. We need some open space. We've been told we're going to get it for a long time, and we haven't. There's nothing left. Once this is built, you'll have close to 240 house lots with not one bit of open space. And even listening to the other public hearing, that's a major concern in the town. Looking in the comprehensive plan, that's a major concern in the town. Well, here's one place where it's been overlooked. We have nothing. There'll be 240 house lots, and there won't be one bit of open space for people to walk in, to cross-country ski in. There won't be one place to remind us of what attracted us to Cape Elizabeth in the first place. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Perry. Are there some other members in the public that would like to comment?
I'm Julian Coles. I live at 15 Roundabout Lane. And that house is this one right in the resource protected zone right here. And if you've taken the site walk, hopefully most of you'll notice that I'm high on a hill, and it isn't a natural hill. It's a sand fill that goes up probably a good 6 or 8 feet to get above the natural water table down in this area, built long before I arrived in Broad Cove. And having lived in this area for the last 10 years, it seemed to me up until about 4 or 5 years ago that no one, including Mr. Balfour, had much interest in this land for obvious reasons if you've taken the site walk. Even in the driest of seasons, it's muddy and mucky, and I don't know the technical term for it, but it's certainly a better place for animals than human beings. But for probably a number of reasons, maybe the sewer coming into our neighborhood that made this land possibly more attractive for development, the building of this road, which to the best of my knowledge and following it, was done illegally, and it was described as being a mistake that only was done to help the developer and the neighborhood out in terms of getting in and out of Broad Cove while we had our sewers put in. But it does seem to me to be coincidental that with the road mistakenly being built and the sewers, which stop right here to the left of my house and right here, they certainly are pretty close to being able to service these 13 lots. And it just would appear to me that if this, for some reason, does not qualify as a wetland in relationship to our zoning and our comprehensive plan, having lived in this area for 10 years, I can't imagine what does. So I would hope, if everybody's taken the site walk, that for all the technical reasons that we're hearing, and certainly for Mr. Perry's more detailed description, just the practical, logical look at this land would indicate that it ought to be left the way it is. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Coles. Other members?
Madam Chairman, my name is Edmund Lovett. I live right here. I live at 31 Broad Cove. And I guess I'm one of those people that Ed Perry was talking about. I just bought my house about 3.5 years ago, so it was after rezoning. And I guess the point I wanted to make about that is that you people are about to make a statement as to what's going to happen in Cape Elizabeth. You made a statement several years ago that resource-protected land was important and that it was important in this area. And I and several others have bought houses, have moved into the community, in fact, on that basis and on the basis of what you presented in the comprehensive plan. When my wife and I came here, we looked at about 15 different communities and decided to live in Cape Elizabeth, and in particular in that area. And this had a great deal to do with it. And as Ed Perry said, I was one of those people that went down to the town hall and talked to Mr. Daigle and talked to others, and they said, oh yes, that's a wetland. And actually, that's such a wetland that my wife and I had to dig a trench across our backyard to drain our backyard for a period of time. And as Julian said, if any of you have walked back there, you realize this is quite a wetland. But I know that that's not the question you're really after. And I'm sure that Dr. Rand can speak to the quality of the land and the quality of the soils and whatnot. But I think the question that is being begged here tonight is, where's Cape Elizabeth going and what's going to happen to its protected land? I hope you vote against this. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Lovett. Are there some other members in the public that would like to speak?
I'm Bob Sigler. I live at 4 Pine Ridge, and my boys asked me to come tonight and just tell the board that they would like to continue to catch their tadpoles in the spring, their frogs all summer, and continue to watch the ducks nest on the water down there, because it is the only land we have left in the Broad Cove area where they don't have to cross busy roads to get to, where we have some wildlife. And I, moving here in 1980, also assumed that that would be protected forever. Thank you.
Mr. Stickler, could I just ask you, you said you had nesting ducks in
yes,
that area?
Yes, there are nesting ducks.
What kind of ducks?
I don't know my ducks.
You better get your ducks in a row.
I know the difference between a duck, a seagull, and a goose, and they're ducks.
But they use it as a nesting habitat?
There certainly are nesting ducks down there in the spring and summer, yes.
Thank you very much. Yes. Other members of the public that might like to comment?
My name is Rachel Perry, and I live at 10 Pine Ridge Road. I'd like to speak this evening about wetlands, about abandonment, and about open space. As it pertains to Mr. Balfour's zone change request from resource protected to residential. This resource protected district Mr. Balfour wants rezoned to residential is a wetland. The technical reports and letters that you have in your packet confirm the wetland designation. Daryl Brown of Mainland Development Consultants points out that Sebago Mucky Peat dominates the site. Two other wetland soils, Scarborough and Walpole, are also present. The three other remaining soil types, Deerfield Loam, Hollis, and Hinckley, comprise approximately 6% of the total wetlands area, and that is considered an inclusion in a wetland. Of these last three soils, Hollis is associated with ledge, and the 1,000 square feet of Hinckley is the fill material at the back of lot 101. Deerfield Loam, Hollis, and Hinckley are the soils on the lot proposed for the communal sewage disposal site. These soils rate severe to very severe for sewage disposal in the Cumberland County Soil Survey published by the U.S. Department of Agriculture. Mr. Stinson of Sebago Technics, in his report, points out that technical treatment of this site has to be done with extreme care. With today's stock technology, homes can be built anywhere. But federal, state, and local governments have made some decisions about the appropriateness of land use and have set aside land as resource protected. Mr. Hunter, our town engineer, in his letter addresses four major points. One, Lot 99 does not constitute a fill-in lot. Two, the sewer system proposed is not viable. Three, capacity was not designed into the present sewer system to accept the proposed lot. Four, stormwater runoff cannot be handled by the right-of-way proposed. Mr. Malley's report on vegetation notes three major types dominating the site: inland open fresh water, shrub swamp, and wooded swamp. Lot 101 has a small inclusion of upland vegetation and is where the deer cross, as pointed out on the site walk. I'd like to point out that three of the above technical experts confirming the wetland status were hired by Mr. Balfour. The fourth is our town engineer. Abandonment. Our present zoning ordinances state, and I want to quote, "The non-conforming use of any building, structure, lot of land, or portions thereof which has been abandoned shall not thereafter be resumed. A non-conforming use shall be considered abandoned. Number two, when it has been discontinued for a period of 1 year." This is in section 19-36. Mr. Balfour's plot plan for residential housing in a resource protection district is non-conforming. 1964 to 1988 is more than 1 year. I would now like to speak on open space. In my search for local background information, I discovered a comprehensive plan of 1961, which was effective when Mr. Balfour's plot plan originated. I'd like to quote from that comprehensive plan. "The town should encourage the provision in new subdivisions of a common area open to the public, to provide a common area for play and recreation, and to retain as much of the open character of the land as possible. It cannot be overemphasized that the openness of Cape Elizabeth, its rural and semi-rural character, its mixture of woods and fields, and the irregularity of its topography are among its greatest assets in making it a pleasant place in which to live. Since the running of the town is entirely dependent financially upon the revenues from residential properties, these assets must be preserved and protected as the suburban growth continues and as more and more land is taken for new dwellings. 20+ years later, I'd also like to quote from another comprehensive plan dating 1967. Quote, "Park and open space plan. Purpose, to provide adequate play space near or adjacent to schools or where there are no schools within each neighborhood. To provide land for parks and to conserve areas of natural beauty that enhance the quality of the town as a place to live in. To conserve the natural resources of the town. And under standards, at least 10 acres of local park or playground per 1,000 persons shall be provided. Every neighborhood should have a playground and small park located within 1/2 mile of most of its residents. A play field should be provided for each of the larger neighborhoods. And under plan, a playground and small park located in each present and future neighborhood. 20+ years later, since these two town plans were drafted, almost every parcel of land in Broad Cove, except for the 7.5-acre wetlands, is developed. 200+ families of this major subdivision do not have a designated open space. I want to remind you that the average lot size in Broad Cove is 1/2 acre. Our most recent comprehensive plan states, Environmental factors. The Conservation Commission has developed detailed studies on environmentally sensitive lands and recommended a green belt open space system for Cape Elizabeth. The Conservation Commission also recommended that no development be allowed in the following types of areas. A. Sebago Mucky Peat. B. Coastal dunes. C. Tidal marsh. D. Slopes over 15%. E. Flood hazard and resource protection areas. F. Wetland soils. The Conservation Commission also suggests that any proposed development in the following areas consider both the historic and or environmental sensitivity of the site, as well as the possibility of preserving features deemed worthy of such by the Commission. Conclusion, with the development of the sewer system and projected population growth, this may well be our last chance to preserve significant unique areas of the town for future generations. Mr. Balfour says he's meeting the goals of the comprehensive plan. I feel Mr. Balfour did not meet the goals in the 1960s and the 1970s when he developed this subdivision, and he does not meet the goals of the latest Comprehensive Planning Commission survey. The participants of this survey being landowners and taxpayers of Cape Elizabeth. Some of the survey results are 96% of the townspeople feel we need strong land use controls. 97% want to maintain existing scenic views. 85% want to preserve the town's rural character. 71% do not want additional east-west connecting streets within Cape Elizabeth. And 19% of the people who do not want, 19% of these people answered no opinion on the last question. Should Mr. Balfour have been required to provide us with a designated open space in the form of a neighborhood park or trail system in Broad Cove? I think so.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mrs. Perry. We have a question.
Mrs. Perry, just for clarification, did I hear you say that what I consider used to be lot 101, because I can't perceive this as 13 little RP zones. I look at it as one contiguous designation. But on the land that used to be lot 101, did you say that it has been filled? I know that the road has been filled, but this seems to be new information.
On the back of the lot, it seems to be filled. I've looked at some old soils maps, and they don't list the type of soils that are there that have just recently been listed. So I don't know when it was filled. I think it was filled years and years ago.
I see, because there is, of all of the soils, there is one little pocket of Deerfield soil in that area, and then there is some Hollis. All other areas seem to be surrounded by Sebago Mucky Peat and poorly drained soil. And there's just this one little pocket of Deerfield. So you don't...
I'm not referring to Deerfield. The fill is probably the Hinckley.
The Hollis
is, from what I understand, it's from the ledge. There's a slope right behind that lot.
Okay, thank you. I just wanted a clarification.
Okay, thank you.
Dear Mrs. Perry, are there some other members in the public that would like to make comments? Well, I guess the nearest one to the microphone.
I'll be very brief. Pete Ram, the Conservation Commission. Mrs. Perry has covered everything, everybody's covered everything that the Conservation Commission would have said tonight about this, but I'd like to speak more in generic terms and not about this particular parcel, but only as it applies to the general thing, and I think the Conservation Commission would advise the Planning Board that of the lack of wisdom of changing resource protection zones that have been set up as the major method of saving critical wetlands in Cape Elizabeth. This certainly is one of those wetlands. There's no question about the fact that it's wet, in fact, submerged most of the time. But more important than that, the plan here sits right at the narrow place in a wetland that is much larger, perhaps three or four times larger, in this direction, and therefore will control the flow through this property down Broad Cove Brook. Therefore, it would impact on a much larger wetland here, number one. Number two, if it were developed, there would be, in order to develop this, to build up and to deepen the course of the stream down to Broad Cove, would undoubtedly increase the flow of water and certainly make it less regulated than it is now to Broad Cove, thereby potentially increasing the risk of flooding further down. And of course, there's 7.58 or however many acres of Cape Elizabeth wetland area that will be forever removed if it is developed. I think this is one of the reasons that we established the resource protection zone in the first place, and I would strongly suggest it not to change. Thank you.
Thank you. Another member of the public?
My name is John McArdle. I live at 23 Broad Cove Road, which is at the edge of the infamous so-called road in this location. I've been there since 1965. When I came to Broad Cove, there were approximately 15 to 20 houses. Today, there are more than 10 times that number. I never would have believed I'd be standing here tonight talking about a wetlands development. Hundreds and hundreds of thousands of dollars were generated through the sales of lots in Broad Cove. Mr. Balfour stood before this group and said, the reason that 20 and more years have passed since he considered doing anything with these lots was because they were the least desired, who were better lots, more saleable lots, and these were left to last. The reason they were left to last, they are wet, wet, wet. Mr. Rand just struck on something that doesn't appear in your map here. But this so-called brook that runs through here, there are at least three streams that converge into it. At times, the brook is 8 or 9 feet wide and 4 and 5 feet deep. And any further alteration of land is just going to cause some downstream problems in that area. Now, all the literature about the environment and land use, we keep hearing these redundant phrases, okay? Quality of life, quality of life. Preserve the open spaces. 15 houses when I went there, 200-odd houses now, the last 7 acres that haven't been gobbled up, and you want to change a resource protection zone that people spent hours thinking about the concept and implementing. I would urge you, put this thing aside for once and for all.
Thank you, Mr. McCarroll. Are there any others in the audience that have not spoken that would like to speak? If not, I will close the public portion of the meeting, and the Planning Board has certainly received a lot of comment tonight, and I think it should be very helpful in deliberating on what our action might be. Just to explain the procedure, we make a recommendation which would then in turn go to the town council, and they in turn would also have a public hearing. I would ask for comments or questions by board members.
Madam Chairman, if I might, there's been a lot of testimony tonight and in the past about this particular request for a zone change, some of which is relevant and some of which is not to our deliberations from a resource protection to an RA district, but all relevant. in people's feelings about the property. For those portions of the testimony that has been relevant, and for those portions of the material submitted by the applicant that is relevant to the discussion and decision tonight, there are a couple of points that were raised this evening and in the material that we've been sent before. And maybe I should start by saying that years ago when the Planning Board proposed to the Council in concert with the Conservation Commission a number of land parcels in the Cape for resource protection, they did it on the basis of a grand community scale mapping program and wetlands evaluation. And what I see in the applicant's own data that he submitted tonight indicates, confirms that the land is in fact wet. When I look at the material and it says predominantly Sebago mucky peat, which is a principal criteria soil for wetland, when we look at documents that talk about the soils in the area proposed and presented by the applicant, that talks about portions of it being inland open fresh water, portions of it being shrub swamp, portions of it being wooded swamp, except for a small part of 101 and 100, lots 101 and 100. I don't know how much more we should consider or have to consider when we start talking and thinking about what are wetland soils and the material is presented by the applicant himself. I would be amazed if this planning board recommended to the council the changing of this resource protection district to a residential A district, and I would be further amazed if the council, with the technical data presented by the applicant himself, were to change this to a residence A district.
Thank you, Mr. Tinsman. Are there any other comments or questions by the members of the board?
Madam Chair?
Yes, Mr.
Morris. I have to say that the sidewalk that we took as part of this deliberation has to confirm everything that Mr. Tinsman has said, everything shown on the map, so it's my view of it. That the areas that we walked and we feel were all what we would consider wetland, and certainly with standing water in a lot of places. So I'd say that the sidewalk provides no change over what has been presented as far as data is concerned, in my mind.
Thank you, Mr. Mullins. I, too, would like to add at least my confirmation that this properly belongs in a resource protection zone. The applicant's own experts have described it as being predominantly Sebago mucky peat, which is a characteristic of a resource protection zone. The vegetation, which has been outlined in the shrub swamps and in the wooded swamps, are predominantly obligate, which means that 99% plus of the vegetation occurs in those areas. And so I think that's yet further evidence that it is properly classified as it is now. If there are no other points of discussion, I would entertain a motion. I guess just before we do discuss, I have a little problem with lot 101, and I don't know whether Mr. Balfour's expert can help us on that or not. Mr. Dale, if he could have comment on that.
I'm not sure we can help, Madam Chairman. This is lot 101 right here. Mr. Balfour had the Gerald Brown photo survey, I think it was in the fall of 86, and those are the results that you used. The Sebago Technics essentially relied on that. That's pretty recent at least, and so for soil mapping, we're not aware of anybody. I gather the suggestion by Mr. Terry that maybe somebody is still here. Southeasterly end of lot 101, I guess simply not aware of that. As you can see from the topo, goes up pretty sharply right there. Mm-hmm. I know that. I'm not aware of that.
Yes, Mrs. Guthrie.
Mr. Dale, do you know offhand how much land area is covered by this the small little pocket of Deerfield soil?
I can't say for certain, Mrs. Guthrie. I could only approximate off the face of the plan. I guess the same as you. Lot 101 is approximately 18,000 square feet. I don't know if that's a half or a quarter of that lot, so that might be good.
Thank you.
Mr. Daigle, could you comment at all on the composition, the soil composition of that particular lot 101 and its significance or...
Regards to the fill
and the
asphalt?
Yes, the fill and the...
It's unusual for areas of the state to have every now and then a midnight unload of some soil, and I suspect it, or a daytime midnight unload of soil. There are times when a indiscriminate person with a load of fill will dump it. We've had that problem also, for, believe it or not, Cottage Farms Road. So no, we're just not aware of any activity that took place.
Thank you. I guess I'd like to just get a sense from the board as to what your feeling is about that particular lot, as to whether there should be any...
It mystifies me, Madam Chairman, as to why we should be doing anything with that lot at all.
Madam Chairman, I'd like to point out that the lot seems to, what used to be this lot, I should say, seems to lie in two zoning districts, and I would like to... state that section 19-2-10 of the zoning ordinance does have a statement about lots in two or more districts, and in a nutshell, if a lot is in two or more districts, part of it can be extended 30 feet beyond the boundary district line into the lot in the more restricted district. So therefore, since it seems ridiculous to change any designation in that one small area, I wouldn't change an inch of this resource protection designation.
Thank you, Mrs. Guthrie. I think I've heard that refrain before, perhaps. It sounds familiar. are there any other points of discussion before we entertain a motion? And it is a long, lengthy motion. Is there someone in good voice?
Madam Chairman, must we read the findings of fact this evening, or we move the adoption of findings of fact and go quickly to the order?
We have legal counsel here. Is there any problem with that, Mr. Layton?
I would prefer that you read them if you can. We have the benefit of a lot of people who spent a lot of time on this, and I think it would help to have those embodied in the motion so that it's available for the...
Perhaps we'll allow... Thank you, Mr. Leahy. Perhaps we'll allow the composer to read the findings of fact just for comfort's sake.
Before that's done, I think what you're hearing is that you may, if the proposer is Stephen Reed...
Composer, not proposer.
Composer, okay. That you might want to think about item D.
Right.
Okay, with that, I'll read the suggested motion for the board's benefit and for the audience as well. Be it ordered that the Planning Board makes the following findings of fact regarding the request by I. Allen Balfour for a zone change from a Resource Protection District to a Residence A District for lots 84, 90, 93 through 97, and 99 through 104 in the Pine Ridge Road Extension vicinity. The findings of fact will number 3, and it will be lettered. A. Lots numbers 84, 90, 93 to 97, and 99, 102 to 104, and portions of lots 100 and 101 meet both federal and state definitions of wetlands, which are listed in the Resource Protection District section of the zoning ordinance, section 19-2-8, sub 4. The information submitted by the applicant to the John C. Malley Associates Incorporated Wetlands Report dated 3/7/88 and the applicant's site plan and zone change request plan dated 6/6/88 provide evidence that the land area encompassed by the above-mentioned lots are made up of inland open freshwater wetlands, shrub swamp wetlands, and wooded swamp wetlands as defined in Circular 39, Wetlands of the United States, prepared by the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service, and in Wetland Inventory for Use in Shoreland Zoning, prepared by the Maine Department of Inland Fisheries and Game. Both of these documents are referenced in the section of the zoning ordinance that defines the land covered by the Resource Protection District. A finding of fact, second finding of fact is B. Lots numbered 84, 93 through 96, 99, 100, and portions of lots 90, 97, 102, and 103 contain the Sebago Mucky Peat soils type, which is listed in the Resource Protection District section of the zoning ordinance, again, section 19-2-8, sub 4. The information submitted by the applicant, see the Maine Land Development Consultants, Inc. report dated November 20th, 1986, and the applicant's site plan and zone change request plan dated 6/6/88, indicates that the above-mentioned lots are made up of Sebago Mucky Peat soils type, which is listed in the Resource Protection District section of the zoning ordinance, section 19-2-8, sub 4. In fact, the Maine Land Development Consultants report stated that Sebago Mucky Peat dominated the site with the exception of lots 100, 101, 102, and portions of lots 90 and 97. In addition, site observations made by the planning board members at the August 4th, 1988 site walk reinforced the wetland soil characteristics of the lots in question. The third finding of fact is C. The vegetation on the lots in question is predominantly wetlands in nature. The applicant's information to the John C. Malley Associates, Inc. Wetlands Report dated 3/7/88 and the applicant's site plan and zone change request plan dated 6/6/88 and site conditions observed by the planning board during its August 4th, 1988 site visit provide evidence that substantial wetlands vegetation, both obligate and facultative, exists on the lots in question. Okay, those are the ends of the findings of fact as suggested. Then the recommendation would be, just a moment, be it therefore ordered, as the recommendation, be it therefore ordered that the planning board recommends to the town council that the zoning map not be amended to lots 84, 90, 93 through 97, and 99 through 104, but rather that they remain in the Resource Protection District designation, period. That's the end.
It has been moved and seconded. Any discussion? All those in favor of the motion, please raise your right hand. Opposed? It is unanimous. The mover was Mr. Tinsman, and the seconder, Mrs. Guthrie. I do want to thank Mr. Dale and Mr. Balfour for their presentation and also the abutters and neighbors for their presentations. Just for the record, this vote does not mean any approval or disapproval of sewers, roads, subdivisions, or any of the above. And it will, this request will be forwarded to the town council. Our next item of business is Spinnaker Heights coming in for a minor subdivision
as a minor subdivision coming in for final plan review. And Mr. Owen, you are going to represent tonight?
That's
Dr.
Correct, Madam
Owen.
Chair. Here again.
I think before you begin, I would just like to make a comment that there has been some ongoing discussion to keep in mind about the necessity or not the necessity of having a wetlands alteration permit. And so we may call on our town council to address that particular point, and I just want everyone to be aware of that perhaps not being ultimately resolved. Okay.
Thank you. I'd like to use this graphic, if I may, and if I could indulge the audience, those of them who aren't with us, to move over here, maybe I can move it a little closer to the board.
With those of you perhaps in the back who won't be able to see this when the easel moves, want to come over. There's some fine side seats there that might give you a better view.
May I proceed? First of all, I'd like to thank the board for granting us an extension, ostensibly allowing us to have a very informative meeting with the Conservation Commission, where we also spent considerable time discussing wetlands. Included in the packet of information that I provided you for this meeting are several letters, two of which are from Mr. Maxwell and from Mr. Toothaker, both abutters to the property, who basically have stated, if I may paraphrase, that the plan as proposed poses no problem for them as far as drainage from Mr. Maxwell's strawberry fields or further upstream, if you will, from Mr. Toothaker's property. There's also a letter, a long-awaited letter, if I may add, from Mr. Hardcastle from the Department of Human Services, basically stating that he and Mr. McBain and Mr. Frick did indeed visit the septic disposal sites, and basically I think has given his approval for the state on that. Now on to what I think are more substantive issues, and those are the question of wetlands. After a meeting with Dr. Rand and the other members of the Conservation Commission, it became apparent there was a difference in opinion as to what indeed was wetland on their property and what was not. When we first began the planning for our subdivision, we mapped the wetlands using the criteria, which we'll describe again in detail, basically the Army Corps of Engineer technique, using a criteria of soils, hydrology, and vegetation. Using that technique, we came up with the wetlands, which are basically outlined as the hatched area. I'll come back in more detail on this. The Conservation Commission has informed us that the ordinance that presently is in existence in the town of Cape Elizabeth basically categorizes all of our land as wetland. This presents an obvious problem to us to proceed with our subdivision. What I'd like to do right now is to have Mr. Frick come up and address some of the issues regarding the soils, which by the 1984 soil survey of Cumberland County are classified as very severely restricted for development, and elaborate on that a little bit. Then I'd like to review our technique that we use to determine the wetlands. And finally, I'd like to justify our wetland boundary given those pieces of information. So if I may, I'd like to call Mr. Frick, please.
Thank you. hard thing to position for everybody to see it. Basically, what we tried to do, and I'll remove the overlay of the vegetation at this time, just to concentrate on the soils, and then John Lordy, who mapped the wetland vegetation, will discuss the wetland vegetation. Basically, what we've tried to do with this graphic is summarize the soil conditions in the site. The very dark red, which is mapped as Waitley, is the very poorly drained unit within that subdivision. The orange colors are the poorly drained sections of the soil that have a water table at or near the surface. As we progress to the lighter shades of yellow, this darker intermediate color between orange and yellow is the somewhat poorly phases of the soil where the water table is progressing to be deeper below the existing soil surface. And the light yellow, this area in here, and in here, and small inclusions are the areas that are deemed to be moderately well drained. Based on the Cumberland County Soil Survey, which is referenced in the wetlands definition, most of this property would be classified as wetland. There's one minor difference in what Tony said. The Lyman soils would not be classified as wetlands, but all the other soil types would be. Even including the areas that we have proposed for the subsurface wastewater disposal system, and which have been checked by the Division of Health Engineering. Those areas are moderately well drained, but if you reference the Cumberland County Soil Survey, referencing to Deerfield and Elmwood soils, they would be deemed to be wetland, as well as the soils across the road progressing into Maxwell's strawberry field. So there seems to be a problem with regards to definition of wetlands and what is commonly accepted as wetlands boundaries. Now, the Soil Conservation Service has revised a publication which is entitled Hydric Soils of Southern Maine, and it's dated December 3rd, 1986, which is intended by the Soil Conservation Service to clarify what is typically deemed to be wetlands with regards to soil. And that goes on to specifically list those type of hydric soils that are commonly considered wetlands. And that would be confined to the dark red and this orange area, what would be the Soil Conservation Service current definitions of wetland soil. And this is, and we have copies of this for the board. I believe they have it. They don't have
Conservation Commission on September 1st, and the deadline for submission was September 2nd, so that some of the research that we did didn't allow us to get the information to you at the commission time.
Madam Chairman, can I also ask, ask a question? The material that was submitted tonight looks like the same material that was given to us as part of our new wetland ordinance criteria for the types of soils that are considered wetlands. It looks very familiar. Mm-hmm. I presume that it's the same.
Madam Chair, the hydric soils of Southern Maine, the board seen two or three times before. I'm not sure about the hydric soils. I think you may have only seen that once or twice.
So, in summary, what the mapping units and the hydraulic soil classification, we feel, were done in the spirit of the proposed new ordinance, and also feel that it perhaps meets the current ordinance if allowed interpretation that allows for, as it says in the definition of wetlands, land areas that are periodically submerged or saturated with water as indicated by the vegetative characteristics as defined in Circular 39 of the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service, or any revision or replacement thereof, and all areas designated as having severe or very severe constraints for development, and so on. So what we're suggesting is that the new data with regards to the hydric soils of Maine, the publications included with the new upcoming wetlands ordinance, is more in tune with what is currently considered to be wetland soil, and it is, I'll allow John Lordy to discuss the wetlands vegetation, John.
Before John starts, the point that I'm trying to suggest is that what we've seen in the last 4 years since the soil survey of Cumberland County, which is referenced in the definition of wetlands, was last published, is that there's been an evolution in the concept of what wetlands are. We went from 1984, when this is all wetlands except for the small pieces of lime, and to 1986, when only the darker orange and the red are wetlands, to now we are in 1988, when the current thinking and the most recent technology employs not only soil types, but also hydrology and vegetation to categorize wetlands.
The 1988 version relying on the United States Fish and Wildlife?
Yes, the Army Corps of Engineers technique in the U.S. and S&W. To explain further, the most current methodology in determining wetlands and the method we use, John Lordy.
Well, I'm also going to give you all a handout. And basically what I'll do is walk you through it very quickly, and you can just have it for reference material after that. It's just a few pages that were taken out of the Army Corps of Engineers Wetlands Delineation Manual. I'm sure most of you are pretty familiar with the general idea that's included in here. The Army Corps of Engineers, as well as a number of local state agencies, has been evolving their methods for not only identifying but also for delineating wetlands. And this case shows, and as the case prior to this one tonight shows, that wetlands are becoming more and more, or coming in front of us increasingly more and more. And defining the exact extent of a wetland in an area is not an easy task, as I'm sure many of you are aware. It's very difficult to put a fine line on a wetland habitat when you have a gradient of habitats. As you go from a wetland, there's not a defined line in most cases where you have there's your wetland, there's your upland. Many instances you have your wetland, then you'll have a slope, and your wetland will eventually grade into your upland habitat. So you could ask, a few years ago, you could ask 10 people to say, well, where's that line? And one person who was maybe trying to say the wetland was smaller would say it's right on the edge of where the cattails are. Another person would say, well, no, it's way upslope where the last cattail is. Well, where do you draw that line? The Army Corps of Engineers, recognizing this problem, put together a group of the top wetland scientists in the country to basically put together this pamphlet. And the delineation technique uses three criteria, basically hydrology, hydric soils, and hydric vegetation. Okay, for each state in the country, there's a pamphlet put together like this, like we have for the state of Maine, called Wetland Plants of the State of Maine. In here, you'll see there's a list of, literally thousands of plants that occur in wetlands and some that occur in uplands. Each of the plants is given a rating. It's given a 1 of 5 rating. It's either obligate, that means it occurs in wetlands 99% of the time. It's facultative wetland, which means it occurs in wetlands 67% to 99% of the time. It's a facultative plant if it occurs in wetlands 33% to 67% of the time. It's an upland plant if it's less than 33%, and or facultative upland if it's greater than 1% and less than 33%, and it's an upland if it's less than 1%. So they've scrutinized, the wetland scientists basically put together this list, and from their own knowledge, they rated all of these plants in here. And it's been very finely scrutinized, to say the least. And basically, this technique, my point is that this technique is the state of the art, and your new ordinance generally reflects the techniques that the Army Corps of Engineers uses. And I think that, you know, when we're dealing with wetlands, it's best to use the most current information available. And in any problem like this, there's not an easy solution. And I think that using the best information is probably the best way to go. So,
John, excuse me, can I ask you to elaborate, just take a couple minutes and explain how you might assess the site when you look at the predominant vegetation and how you pick the most common.
He explained this to us, I think, on our site walk. Are there any that are not familiar with this?
Okay. The reason I brought it up, Madam Chair, there weren't questions at the last board meeting as to how Mr. Lordy could make this determination. And I wanted to make sure that those questions were answered.
There were some who weren't on the site walk.
Okay, if you turn to the last two pages of the handout that I just gave you, you'll see there's data forms that are part of this technique. On page, the right-hand part of the first page of the second two pages, if you got that, you're doing well, you'll see at the top is vegetation, okay? As I mentioned before, there's three criteria. In the vegetation category, you'll see trees, sapling shrubs, liana, which are basically woody vines, and then seedlings and herbs. You go into an area, and you look at what are the three dominant tree species in the stand. You write down the tree species, okay? Then you look at your sapling or shrub category. What are the three dominant saplings and shrubs in this area? You write down those species. You look and see if there's any woody vines, you do the same thing, and you look at your herbs, which are your ferns, your sedges, grasses. You put down your three dominant species. Then you go through this manual, which I showed you before, look up the rating, and if more than 50% of the plants that were dominant in that area have a rating of facultative, facultative wetland, or obligate, the area is considered to be dominated by hydric vegetation. So it meets the hydric vegetation criteria, meets one of the three criteria. The next thing you do is you look at your soil types, and you look and see if it's a hydric soil, and you also look and see if there's modeling in the soil, if it's glade, if there's iron concentrations, things that happen to a soil when it becomes reduced because of saturation. If it meets those that criteria and it meets the vegetation criteria, you got two out of three. The next thing you look for is signs of hydric conditions. Okay, you look, are there watermarks on their trees? Are there pockets of leaves that are real dark, dark brown from where water has sat and may have evaporated if it was the summer? Are the trees that are growing in the area buttressed? Okay, trees that grow in a very wet area the roots will basically buttress the tree up. Are there wind throws? You look for signs like that, and those are indications of very hydric conditions. And if the site meets all three of these criteria, the Army Corps of Engineers considers it to be a wetland. And the reason it's so important to use all three criteria is that when you are going from a wetland to an upland situation, if you want to make a fine line or the best defensible line, the site should meet all three criteria. Okay, vegetation, typically you'll have a group of species that may be rated in here facultative. Remember, facultative plants can only occur in wetlands 33% to 67% of the time. So you can have plants that occur in uplands a lot of the time and in wetlands, and it can be very deceiving. When you're trying to draw this fine line, you may have a species like purple loosestrife. It's that pretty purple flower that blooms in August. That's a very ubiquitous species. It will grow in upland situations as well as wetlands. And if you just rely on your vegetation, some instances your line is going to be put in the wrong place. If you just rely on your soils, your line is going to be put in the wrong place also. If you just rely on inundation alone, it's going to be the same thing. So by putting together all three criteria, you're actually using the best available information to put that defined, that defined line on your wetland boundary.
Madam Chairman,
I had a
question. That's probably one of the best technical descriptions I've heard, given a couple of meetings we've had on our new wetlands ordinance, and I missed the sidewalk, so I didn't hear it. But with all of that, and I believe that, where have you mapped wetlands or indicated any boundaries where you consider after this analysis that the wetlands are?
Yeah.
Is that what the overlay is?
This is, the hatched area is basically the area that met the Army Corps of Engineers criteria.
Which is all three or two out of three?
All three.
All
three. Any other questions of Mr. Lord? Did you have another presentation?
Just a little bit more to add on. Okay. Appreciate your indulgence. The board might consider a new clipboard here.
We've just been informed, Barb, right up at to the state of the art here.
Given the nervousness of the presenter,
that it is new.
Hard to tell if I'm nervous.